You ready to pod?
I'm ready. You ready?
Okay, I'm ready.
How you feeling?
I'm feeling good. You?
Feeling strong.
Okay, good. Now,
exuberant.
Yes.
Effervescent.
Sparkly.
Vital.
Sparkly.
Vital and virile.
All right, you ready? We got work to do.
I know. All right, let me. What we're talking about today?
We're gonna talk about the state of education.
We're gonna wing it. We're gonna get a little controversial today.
Yes. You know, I think you have to stand up for what you believe in. If some people don't like it and they consider it controversial, that's what they consider controversial.
Well, you know what? I don't really care. You know me.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, let's start it. Hang on.
Ready? Sit nice and straight. Use your voice.
Okay.
Okay.
Hi, I'm Tom Bylick.
And I'm Michele Piskel.
And we're the Tomfoolery Fun Club.
And yes and then.
That's right. Don't forget about yes and then.
No, we can't forget about
that.
Our
little stepchild. This is straight out of Tomfoolery, our weekly podcast. And this is episode, I don't know, whatever.
Eight.
Eight or nine. And we're going to talk a little bit about education today. We've got a show coming up before we talk about anything. Our show on May 5th, Friday night, Cinco de Motown. It's the whole reason we're doing the show is to raise funds.
Yes.
Right? I mean, that's the primary reason. Well, we want to do a show. We love doing the show. Isn't
right.
it fun? But this particular show is designed to raise money for one of the local high schools here, Hammond High School.
Yes.
And they've been without a band and a choir for many years. And just recently, last year, started up the band again. And this year, started up the choir again.
Yes.
And we're helping to raise some money to actually equip these organizations with some decent equipment.
Right, you need choir robes to go perform, or even just to perform on stage at school if they're going to do a concert, maybe with the band. The band needs instruments.
To do it right.
Right.
You can't pass around four clarinets to...
No.
I mean, one clarinet to four people.
No,
and, you know, that's just not the way to do it. So every kid needs their own instrument. Every choir member needs their own robe. And those are some of the things that we're doing in order to uplift this program, to get it back to where it used to be and to where it should be so that it can be competitive with other schools throughout the area.
Exactly. They need the same opportunities that kids in other districts have, whether it's a district that may be slightly more affluent and the parents may have money, or a district that is similar to theirs and they also have the programs and they have robes and they have instruments. So the students at Hammond High deserve the same thing that other
right.
children are getting in Northwest Indiana as far as education.
We know a lot of these schools where people have a little bit more disposable income. Mm-hmm. For example, parents can rent equipment or even
right.
buy instruments or contribute. But we know in other areas like in Hammond, in East Chicago, in Gary and other places, let's face it, people are broke. They don't have any money to spend on these types of things.
Or they don't have extra disposable income that
no.
is a choice to spend.
No, they things. Don't. Through whether it's their own fault or the fault of somebody else, we basically are, the children are paying the price.
Yes.
Because they're not given the equal access. So it's separate but unequal, as my friend
right.
Teddy M will say, about the state of education in many areas. Which kind of brings us to what we want to talk about today. And we've got a couple of things happening this week in Northwest Indiana.
Yes.
Two school districts have referendums on the ballot.
Yes.
Two vastly different school systems in terms of the socioeconomic environment.
Yes, and just the cultural makeup also of
right.
it and the demographics of where they're located.
So we were having a little conversation about this last night.
Yes.
Over a couple of glasses of vino.
Yes.
And we decided to just kind of wait and hold it today.
Yes. And I'm impacted by both. There's a referendum in East Chicago and there's a referendum in Munster. And those both impact me and my daily life, actually. The referendum in Munster impacts me because that's where my children go to school.
Right.
And the referendum in East Chicago impacts me because that's where I go to work every day.
So you're more directly involved with it than probably anybody.
Yes.
I like to feel I'm involved with it in a more indirect way because I live here. I live in this area.
Right.
And whether or not the current school system that we reside in is under review or not, referendum, that doesn't mean it's not going to happen next year
right.
or the year after.
Right.
So we need to be thinking about these things as to where is education going Where is it now, and where is it going? Now,
that's a huge question.
A couple of the referendums that are on the ballot right now, for example, the first one in East Chicago, lower socioeconomic population.
Yes, we're a Title I district, which about equates us to about at least 85% of the families are below poverty. It may be higher, but that's a low guesstimation on my part. And so the socioeconomic status of many of the families are lower than Munster's.
Free lunch programs, yes. That type of thing. Okay. Yes. And the implication there is if the referendum does not pass, then potentially they'll have to close a school, right?
Yes.
Reduction in force in terms of teachers. Right. And so on. So there's that. That's the implication.
Yes.
Now in Munster, which is a different socioeconomic class, more middle class, upper middle class.
Yes.
Okay. Schools have gotten into be a state of disrepair. We know that because the school board members have been pretty vocal about the fact that these schools are starting to show their wear.
Right.
They're leaking when it rains. That type of, and which is okay. I get it. Buildings get older. The implication there. Now, is if the referendum doesn't pass, then property values will be impacted. Could be impacted as much as 10 to 20%, they project.
Right, because that is one of the key factors of why people move to Munster. When I moved to Munster over 20 years ago, it was for the school districts.
Sure.
It was for the schools that were in the district, and I chose and have stayed there all this time because I value that. And so they're saying that if the money does not come in through the referendum, then we cannot hold this to the same standards that we have been in the past. And so our district will be taking a little bit of a dive. And if the school is not as good as it used to be, then people won't be coming here and buying houses.
Okay.
And the homes that are here won't retain value.
So what we're hearing in one case, okay, if the referendum doesn't pass, then we may have to close the school. Which means we bring more kids into classrooms.
Yes, yes.
Instead of having 25, now we've got 30 or 32.
Some of ours are sitting at 30 now.
Well, that's a lot.
Yeah.
And that's too much.
That
we know that's too much. And in the other district, okay, if the referendum doesn't pass, then our property values are going to decline.
Right.
So I guess my question is, and I haven't heard this from either school district, is this, what are the implications to the students?
Right.
If both are passed? Okay, if we pour more money into each of these school systems, how is that going to benefit the students? Forget about property values.
Right.
Forget about closing buildings. You know, having worked in business for many years in the corporate world, when I went to my bosses with an idea for something different, a campaign or a promotion,
right.
And I said, okay, this is what I need. I need $30,000 in order to facilitate this particular program. Their response to me would consistently be, okay, what do we get in return? How is this going to benefit us incrementally,
right,
above and beyond what we currently have? And we had to, I would have to lay out my plan. This is what I want to do. This is what I see coming back in terms of residual, in terms of incremental business. And over the long term, this is how it will benefit us.
Exactly.
Not next month, but next year and the year after.
You have to have a plan.
And we don't wait until we're in reactionary mode.
Right.
We're in dire straits. Hey, if I don't get this money, then my sales territory is going to go out of business. Because the first thing my boss would say is, well, what'd you wait so long for?
Right.
Why are we putting this off to the point now where we have to pour money into it just to save ourselves?
Right.
We want to be thinking ahead. So that's not to blame anybody in the school districts right now.
Right.
Because, you know, we have new school board members in one district. We have new superintendent and board members in the other.
Right.
They're trying to fix the misdeeds of those in the past. And I get that. It's kind of like a salesperson who goes into the territory that was neglected for many years. Now, okay, we got to fix this thing. But the bottom line is, well, where do we go down the line?
Right. Because the face of education is changing. What's happening right now is yesterday when I was getting ready, I like to listen to Pandora, and I heard three separate times on paid commercials through Pandora about the online school here in Indiana.
Right.
Oh, your student can have online classes from home. And I mean, it was a pretty good spiel. I thought, well, I better take that number down. That doesn't even sound half bad. So we're already getting into online schools where there's not even going to be a physical teacher in front of that child. physically that they could touch. It's going to be mm-hmm. someone on a screen that they're looking at and listening to pre-recorded lessons potentially. And we have charter schools, so that's already taking funds and students out of the regular public education. I think what we need to do is totally look at education in general and come up with a massive plan on how are we going to deal with all these transitions. We can't say that, oh wow, we lost, you know, 200 kids this year because they went to charter, they left the state, or they went to online schools. The money follows the child, so if they're not in seats sitting in that classroom, the money's not there. So now we're mm-hmm. really should be looking ahead to education in general and how it's changing in today and how it's going to be looking in 3 years, 5 years, and 7 years. When these referendums finally follow through in 3, 5, 7 years, and now you got all your incremental money, what happens now? You're going to be in another predicament in 7 years.
What is the state of education going to look like in 7 years or 14 years or 21 years? Looking back 20 years ago, are schools now better than they were 20 years ago? Are they different than they were 20 years ago? I think they're about the same. When you think about it, we're still working off of the same model that schools worked off
100 years ago, really.
When Michael Landon went out in the prairie and they built the first little red schoolhouse. Mm-hmm. Okay, you get kids that are housed in a facility, seated in rows, sometimes they're in a circle, horseshoe, whatever. Right. They're listening to a teacher. I know they get up more now and do things, right, and computers, right, and things like that, but it's still basically the same model. And with all the changes in society over the last 20 years especially.
Right, even 10.
And you can just imagine, I mean, I can't even comprehend what's going to be like 20 years from now or 40 years from now. But we know it's going to be different. Are we poised for the future, or are we still just putting Band-Aids on things to say, okay, well, we need a new baseball field. Let's build it, instead of looking at the big picture and saying, okay, instead of having four...
What's your long-term projection?
Four Goat Ranch baseball fields for four schools. Why don't we just build one really nice one?
And you share.
That everybody can share and use it and put some money into it and build toward the future.
Right. Well, there has to be those catalysts that come up with the idea, because a lot of times people go through their day, this is my day, this is my day, this is my day. A lot of people are sitting and pondering and have some awesome ideas. I listen to teachers all the time, and they have some really awesome ideas. Well, take that idea and go talk to who can implement that.
Mm-hmm.
Go talk to who can make that happen. Get a group and go by yourself and get that done.
Well, one of the things that we talk about in our Yes and Then entity is good positive communication and sharing of ideas, and that's how we came up with the company Yes and Then, to say yes to somebody for a change, mm-hmm. instead of always immediately shaking your head no, and oh, no, we did that before, or no, that's going to cost way too much. I mean, to really just put it open and discuss it in an open forum.
Yes.
We advocate that, and we see value in that. And quite honestly, I don't see a lot of that in places in the political arena. It seems like everybody has their own little fiefdom. This mm-hmm. is my this is my kingdom here.
This is my school. This is my classroom.
And it that mentality that spreads to the populace, mm-hmm. to where anytime something new comes along, we don't need that. That's not for us. Before we even have a chance to vet the idea, to really discuss it, to get it out there, to say, okay, do we really need this? And if we do have this, are we going to be better than we were when we didn't have it?
Right. And what I'm seeing coming up from both ends of this referendum is, just in my opinion, what I'm hearing on the East Chicago side is no. I'm hearing a lot of resounding no. Okay, then on the Munster side, yes. Oh my goodness, all over the place. Yes, 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 we have to do this. Okay, why is the mindset so different? The same objective is here. It's for educating children. Why is the mindset so different on these two sides?
Well, my opinion is this. In East Chicago, nobody trusts anybody. There's a total lack of trust, right, based on the history of the last 100 years of political oversight, where you have politicians and others in power that do the power grab, the money grab,
right,
and before you know it, you've got stuff built for people that aren't even living in that area. Right. So as a result, people just don't trust handing over their money to people, right, unless they can say, okay, kind of like what my boss would say to me, okay, if I give you this money, what do I get in return? What does the company get in return?
Exactly.
People in East Chicago are tired of giving money away to people and then never seeing anything, never seeing any improvements.
Right. They're not seeing anything. And what's the plan? What's a concrete plan? The 1 year, 3 year, 5 year plan. Munster should have the same thing. And I was, you know, having this discussion with someone on a Facebook forum for Munster, and someone was saying, no, the last administration had the referendum and they lied and they didn't spend it the way, blah, 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 whatever. And okay, that very well could be true. But in either case, with both sides, in East Chicago and in Munster, hold those people accountable.
Hold people accountable for doing the misdeeds.
This money is going to come this way, and hold them accountable for making sure that happened. If not, you know what? Superintendents everywhere are employees of the school board.
Mm-hmm.
So hold accountable and be transparent with the funds, and there shouldn't be such a big problem.
You know, I'm not a person that doesn't want to see money spent. As far as I'm concerned, they could spend billions of dollars in Northwest Indiana just to get it out of the hole that it's dug itself in over the last 60 to 70 years. Mm-hmm. I mean, we have so much opportunity in this area in terms of, well, we get a lake
proximity
that
to the
other
lake,
cities would
Chicago.
Die for. We have proximity to Chicago, which has millions of people, all with money. And we have a tendency to isolate ourselves, but that's probably a whole different podcast.
Yes, another podcast.
But the fact of the matter is, we have opportunities here, but we have to show a return for the investment.
Right.
If we want to put more money into schools, do we trust those that are going to spend the money to? I don't distrust anybody that is going to be collecting this money. I guess what I just want to hear is how is this going to benefit us down the road? Don't tell me that my property values are going to go down 20%. If we don't pass it, because that's kind of a heavy-handed tactic. I think it's sort of a blackmail type of a tactic, to be honest with you. That doesn't sell me on your
scare tactic.
It doesn't sell me on your ability to improve the lives of my children who are in the schools. If I had small children, I wouldn't be happy with that.
Right.
My reply to that would be, well, you need to come up with a better plan if I'm going to give you this money, because we have a mentality here where people in power feel like they're our rulers. Mm-hmm. Instead of being our servants. I mean, we elect people to serve us, whether they're in politics, whether they're on the school board, which is kind of a political position. It's a voted position.
It is.
They're there to serve us.
Exactly.
They're there to identify what our needs are and put a reasonable plan into place to help us get from point A to point B. And I'm just not seeing that with either one of these referendums.
Right. I'm not sure I am, but this is where I kind of had a tangled mentality myself. Okay, if I'm thinking that in Munster, yes, I want this referendum to pass, I want to keep the schools at the level of integrity that they hold now, then why wouldn't I then also say yes to the referendum in East Chicago? The topic of the referendum is students and educating them. So I know not everybody's going to like that, because I know people dearly who don't want it in East Chicago for different reasons, and that's fine. But if we're really going back to the core of why are we doing this, it's to better educate those kids. And the kids in East Chicago sitting in those seats every day deserve the same kind of education, quality education, and resources that the kids in Munster deserve. So if you say yes to one place, they should have the referendum, then the referendum should be yes to the other place. At the core, it's about kids.
And have a plan.
Yes.
I mean, tell us, okay, this is what's going to happen to, in the short-term test scores, and this is what will happen to these young people down the road when they get out of school and they actually get on into life.
Right.
How is this going to impact their lives to a greater degree, to a more positive degree? Because if we're just putting money into a school system just to keep a building open, or if we're just putting money into a school system to keep property values up, to me, that's not good enough.
No, that's not the purpose.
That's not the purpose of education. The purpose of education is to educate children to make them better than the last generation was. And we're not doing that right now.
Right.
We're not doing that. These kids are not, they're not getting the type of education that I got when I was in school, because they don't have access to a lot of the things that I had and that you had and that other people had. It's just not there. Now, maybe it's a question of money, but on the other hand, we spend a lot of money in this country on things that don't make any sense.
Right.
And I'm all for paying teachers more. I mean, you've been an educator for many.
So am I.
I've dabbled in it from time to time. It seems like every time I get the urge to do it, I go in and try it, and I think, gosh, this is work. This is so much
it's
work.
It's exhausting at the end of a day.
And for the money that you get at the end of the week, you think, this is ridiculous. I mean, if I was a young person going into teaching right now, well, first of all, I'd give it a lot of thought. And I'd have to be really dedicated to improving the lives of others without any financial gain.
And that's what teachers do every day.
You could very well double the salary of every teacher right now, and they would earn every penny of that.
Yes.
Right now, they're grossly underpaid. Many administrators are grossly overpaid. We have to ask ourselves this question,
right,
too.
What value are you bringing for that money?
If a teacher doesn't show up for school tomorrow morning, just doesn't even show up, will he be missed?
Yes.
Yes, because the kids are going to be waiting in their desks. Well, where's the teacher?
Yes.
And they're making, okay, let's say $35,000 or $40,000 a year.
40, 42.
But they're there. Now, if a higher paid administrator doesn't show up for work tomorrow,
I don't know if anybody would know.
Who's going to know the difference?
Their secretary?
No. And that's the way it is in most companies.
Right.
Too. It's the lowest paid workers. The guy taking the order at Dunkin' Donuts tomorrow who is making minimum wage, if he doesn't, she doesn't show up, and those cars are lined up at that window, and nobody's there to serve them, people are going to be really mad.
Right. They're going to be noticed.
Now, if the regional manager for Dunkin' Donuts decides tomorrow morning, hey, I don't really feel like going in the office today.
Who's going to know?
Who cares?
Whose life did he impact?
Yeah, none. And he's probably making whatever. Yeah. Let's just speculate and say, okay, six figures.
Well, I know that a lot of the money, if not all of the money from the referendums, if I'm understanding correctly, is going into the general fund. General fund can be spent in any sort of way,
mm-hmm,
where different pockets of money have to be spent by different stipulations depending on the funding source. And general fund money can be spent in a lot of different ways. And I honestly think that to retain quality teachers, you have to make sure that they feel valued and that their pay is in accordance to their mm-hmm contribution.
The bottom line, for any of this, is how are we going to be better than we were before if we put more money into it? And that goes with anything, whether we're going to build a train, whether we're going to build a theater, whatever we're going to do with these corporate funds, public funds rather, how are we going to be better today than we were last year,
right,
if we spend it? And okay, we know all about the implications, okay?
Right.
We're being sold on the negative. Okay,
yeah.
If you don't do this, if you don't buy this toaster, you'll never enjoy bread again. The bread's gonna go bad.
Right.
We're not being sold on features, advantages, and benefits. We're being basically having things held over our heads.
Yeah.
Which isn't the way to sell things. It's not yeah, a way to, you may get to the end, but people aren't going to be happy about it.
No, and you have a lot of educated people who are going to be voting on these referendums, both in East Chicago and in Munster.
Mm-hmm.
They have facts, they know things, they go and research things, and it's kind of late now because tomorrow, and you know, in a few days, they're going to be voting on that referendum, but they should have looked at how they were marketing themselves and how they were marketing the whole concept of the referendum. Because I don't think they truly let the mission and passion of why they wanted the referendum to be known to the public that was voting for it.
Well, again, it's a reactionary type of a thing. We find ourselves in a situation, we open up our books one day and say, oh, we've got this shortfall. I mean, this should have, things like this, I'm not saying this, but anything should be in the works for months and years,
right,
before we get to this panic point where we say, okay, these are the implications.
Right.
And we see this a lot in politics. When politicians have a presence 2 months before the election. I mean, I can go on my Facebook right now and not see any politician on Facebook.
Right.
But
it gets
make
close
it,
to election
make
time
it and September,
like,
oh, October, yeah, and here I am,
right,
serving soup at the homeless shelter.
Right.
And then,
those people have been homeless for a long time and needing soup for a long time, and where were you all that time?
And the day after the election, then everybody goes back into hiding. They go back into their own little fiefdom and they relax and they say, okay, I got it. I'm in. I'm good for 2 years or 4 years or whatever. And that's not the way to do it. I mean, we have to start holding these people, either politicians or administrators, we have to start holding these people accountable.
Yes.
all the time for what they do.
That's a huge word for me, accountability.
Because we can't keep bailing out time after time after time.
Right, but
because people don't have that kind of money anymore.
Right, no, but we do have to say, in defense of UChicago, we do have a lead crisis actually, which did put a huge impact on resources, and so. I can see why, unfortunately, but I can see why we are now in the, my hair's on fire, let's get this done.
That was an unforeseen circumstance.
Yes, so in our
However, case. The quality of education, that's not an unforeseen circumstance.
No.
We know that we've had too many kids in these classrooms now for far too long.
Right, right. And it always says, oh, we don't have the money, I think we need to, everywhere in education, we need to look at how we're allocating that money and those funds. And if you're truly, like you said, learning for all, whatever it takes, then stick to that. And right. Learning for those kids, whatever it takes, we are going to cut that because we need to get it back in the classroom. Who impacts those kids every day? The teacher. The teacher is in front of them every day. Mm. She impacts them every day. We need to support them.
You know, we'll kind of close on this, but we have to take a longer look at what things are going to look like 20 years from now and 30 years from now. And do we keep pouring money into this way, or do we start investing in the future in some other way? Right. And that holds to things like roads and transit and economic development and things like that. We can't just keep throwing good money after bad. We have to look out to the future and say, okay, this is what we want, not what's it going to look like, but what do we want it to look like?
Exactly, with some foresight.
Every time I think about this area, in any area for that matter, I think about post-Chicago Fire, and I think about Daniel Burnham sitting down at his architect table, and he takes out his pencil and his T-square, and he maps out the whole city of Chicago as this is what it should look like.
Exactly.
And if you look at the city of Chicago right now, from an aerial view, it looks remarkably like Burnham's plan. There's some differences.
The key is have a plan.
But they had a plan, and they stuck to the plan, and they built one of the greatest cities in the world.
Yes. Well, for anywhere in education right now, what's your plan? Anywhere from San Francisco to New York to Memphis, Tennessee to Joliet, Illinois to Munster, Indiana. What is your plan? You have online schools. You have charter schools, you have Catholic schools, the money now goes to wherever the child goes. You have a new Secretary of Education. You know, what are schools going to look like? Are they going to be online? Are we going to need all these brick and mortar buildings? We have to start thinking about that. What's education going to look like in 5, 10, 15 years?
I don't know. I'm not sure the people that are in charge of these decisions really have any idea.
Well, then when the kids leave and the money leaves, then what do we do? I think we need to start looking at that.
I think we have work to do, and we're trying. We're doing our little part by first of all doing little things like this. We're helping out to raise money where we can for places like Hammond High School to make a few dollars for their band so they can buy an extra flute or an extra trumpet or whatever.
Trying to get after school programs in the building.
But what
we
are capable of doing is just a slice of what society as a whole is capable of doing.
Exactly.
Because that's where the money is. That's where the tax money is, and we as taxpayers. We need to start having a little bit more say-so as to where this money is going, and more importantly, what are we going to get in return?
Right, your vote matters.
Right. So get out there, get voting.
And you have a voice.
Go to meetings, vote, and if you're not happy with what you're seeing, then let people know about it.
Right.
But have an idea of your own.
Right, don't just complain. Come with an idea. Come with a solution. Come with a suggestion.
Right.
Because we have enough complainers. We don't need any more of those.
Don't need any more of that.
No. You have an idea, you have a concern, come with a way to fix it.
Right. Okay. Well, I feel better. How about you?
Yes.
Okay. Well, this has been another exciting episode of Straight Outta Tomfoolery.
Yes, and you get me charged when you start talking about kids and education.
Thanks for joining us. We sure appreciate that. Try to come out May 5th. All proceeds for that fundraiser on Friday night, May 5th, at Wicker Park Social Center in Highland, Indiana, goes directly to the Hammond High School Artistic Endeavors Fund. They're going to be able to get some cool things, but we need support. We need support from the community. We need support from alumni. You can go on our website and go to the ticket link and just make a donation.
Right. If you're out of the,
but we need that help.
$5 makes a difference.
$5.
100 people
even a
at
dollar.
$5.
Take a dollar.
100 people at $5 is 500.
Yeah. Just, it takes, like you say, it takes a village to do these things.
It takes a village.
So I guess my question is, where's the village?
Okay. Come on, people.
Where
up.
Are you? Come on out of your huts.
We need
and
you.
Let's get some things going.
The kids need you.
Yeah.
They are our future. People are like, oh, that's a... Right. Yeah, it's beyond a quote. It's beyond, really, they truly are our future.
That's a...
And it's our responsibility to take care of them.
That's the honest truth. Mm. Well, anyway, thanks for tuning in. We appreciate it. This is another episode of Straight Out of Tomfoolery. I'm Tom Bylick.
And I'm Michele Piskel.
And we'll see you next time. That's good.
Yeah. Almost 30 minutes.
Yeah. Whoa. 30 minutes.
It's 29.
We were talking.
I know. All right. Get me on that topic.
You feel better?
I have vented.
I'm going to get a little more coffee.
I need some more, too.
Yeah. Let me help you out.
Let's do a slight playback on that.
I